Maybe I'll ask you a couple of questions. I want to make a couple of polls to know what you already know or not. So how many of you knows about basics about supersymmetry? Raise your hands. Okay. Okay, that's good because probably we will not need the supersymmetry in this talk. So what? How many of you knows basics or at least have heard about instantons? Okay, and what about chiral Lagrangians and fatty pions Lagrangians? Okay, okay. So today I will start discussing about the theta problem and possible solutions. So what's the theta problem? So as we saw last week from Rattazzi's lectures, the standard model is an effective Lagrangian. And we should write all the dimension four and less operators that are allowed by superselection by selection rules. In particular, there is a term that you can write in the Lagrangian of QCD, which is the theta term, which has the form minus theta naught over some normalization factor times FF tilde. Where in this normalization I'm choosing F tilde to be 1 half epsilon mu nu rho sigma F rho sigma. Okay, so this term is allowed by symmetries. It violates CP, so the only symmetry breaks is CP, but after all in the standard model CP is already broken. And it's a total derivative. These terms, FF tilde, can be rewritten as the derivative of a quantity, which is AF minus a third AAA, where the indices here are saturated with the epsilon tensors, and the gauge indices are saturated with the structure constant of the gauge group. So it's a total derivative, which means that at the perturbative level, at any order, it does contribute after you satisfy the equation of motion. But already at classical level, you can show that there are gauge configuration with non-trivial FF tilde and with finite action. These gauge configurations are called instantons, and they are the solution of this linear equation. F equal to plus or minus F tilde. So I'm not going to go into the details of this solution, I'll just mention some properties. So these are solutions where at infinity the gauge fields goes to a pure gauge, it doesn't go to zero. A mu does not go to zero, but go to a pure gauge, which means that the field strength goes to zero. And this guarantees that the action is finite. But since a mu doesn't go to zero, since this the integral of the Lagrangian is a total derivative, you'll get a contribution from here at the boundary, where A is non-zero, and it give you a finite result. This finite result is a topological invariant, and is such that the integral over FF tilde is equal to 32 pi square times an integer. So now you understand why I normalized here this term with the 32 pi square, so that I get just an integer times theta naught. I think I. Okay, so since F is equal to F tilde, now if you calculate the contribution of this gauge configuration inside the path integral, for example, the Euclidean path integral, you'll get a contribution that goes like e to the minus s, where s is computed on this gauge configuration. So this is e to the minus integral of the kinetic term, which here is normalized as this. And since F is equal to F tilde, you can relate F square to the integral of FF tilde, which is 32 pi square n. So this is also e to the minus 8 pi square over g square by substituting this. So you see that a small coupling, the contribution of these gauge configurations in the path integral e to the minus s is exponentially suppressed. So this one thing I didn't say, so is these configurations you see are a solution of the classical action of QCD. The classical action of QCD is scale invariant. This configuration, however, have a scale, and the scale is the size of the instanton where this energy density is enclosed. Since the solution breaks this scale invariance, the solution basically you find a solution for any values of the size of the instanton, and basically this constant is basically just the integration constant of when you solve this first order differential equation. So now you should ask what gauge couplings you have to put inside this action. Well, at three level, at the classical level, the action is gauge invariant, G is a constant, but we know that the scale invariance is explicitly broken by the running of the gauge coupling. So this gauge coupling is mu dependent, and there is no surprise that when I introduce the full loop contribution, the scale that enters here will be just the size of the instanton, because it's the only scale in the problem. So this means that you have solution of every size. In the path integral, you have to sum over all gauge configuration. In particular, you have to sum over all the sizes of the instantons. So small instantons means large scale, which means small g. So small instanton are perturbative, but contribute with exponentially small factor. Large instantons instead becomes non-perturbative, g becomes of order one, and they contribute the most. So this the contribution from instanton to the QCD action is dominated by large instantons. Unfortunately, large instantons are those that have large coupling. They become non-perturbative, so they are not calculable. In particular, the action becomes of order one, so the saddle point approximation we use to estimate this contribution breaks down. Indeed, this can be shown that at the end, the dependence that is induced to theta, it's completely not dominated by instanton, by semi-classical instantons. And this we're going to see later today. Of course, I didn't put this extra contribution. If I put this extra contribution here, I get plus I theta, if I consider only one instanton. So this will be plus I theta. And if you sum over all instanton positive and negative charge, you'll get basically, after you sum over one instanton plus one anti-instanton, this is an integer which can be plus or minus one, and you get contribution which goes like this. So you find in this case that the theta is physical. The energy density, if you want, the vacuum energy depends on theta with a cosine when you consider only small instantons that are the one you can compute. Any questions? Yes. Which one? This one? I subtracted what? It's equal. Sorry. Okay, in QCD, well, we have also fermions. So fermions have a axial symmetry we can use. which is the following. If you take a fermion Q, a quark, we can make the following transformation, e to the I gamma 5 alpha. Under this transformation, the action is the path integral is not invariant. In particular, the measure of the path integral transform non-trivially. This is just the anomalies. Transform with a phase, and the phase is just what you get from triangular anomalies, is proportional to FF tilde again. Yes, thanks. It's just a phase, which is proportional to alpha. And this tells us a very important thing. It tells us that actually this theta I define here is not physical, because after a field definition, I can shift it by alpha, by 2 alpha, because there is a system. So under the field redefinition, theta effectively, I call it theta naught. Sorry. Theta naught shifts by 2 alpha. However, if in your QCD action the quarks are massive, then under this field definition you also have another variation. In particular, the mass term transforms into this quantity, because Q we are shifting with the chiral transformation, which transforms left and right with opposite signs. So the mass gets a phase, which means that under this field definition, the argument of the mass of the quark also effectively shifts by the same phase. This means that under field definition, this theta naught is not physical, the argument of the mass is not physical, but there is a physical contribution, a physical quantity combination, which is theta naught minus the argument of M, which is invariant under field definition. So if you have quarks in your Lagrange, you have fermions that are in complex representation of the gauge group, individually theta naught and the argument of M are not physical quantities. They depend on the choice of the fields, but this combination is. If you have more fermions, of course you have the same for any fermions, and you can write this more generically as the argument of the determinant of M, because you get a phase for each M. So the argument of the product of M is the sum of the arguments. So note that individually theta naught and the argument of M break both parity and time inversion, so they break CP. So having a non-trivial theta means that CP is broken. And now this tells you that if you want theta to be very small, as we will see, you get a problem. You get a problem because you, in order to be zero, either they are both had to be zero, or they must be a cancellation between the two. Now, theta naught arises just from gluon dynamics, if you want, in the gluon sector. Instead, the phase in the mass matrix, in the quark, in the standard model, arises from the electroweak sector, in particular the U-kava sector and the cup into the Higgs. So in particular, in general, you will expect them to be completely unrelated. And on top of this, we know that off diagonal phases in M, the CKM phase, are order 1. So it will be quite surprising if the argument instead is 0. So you will expect at the same level as the CKM phase to be order one or other phases to be order one. And then this makes, if you want, the theta problem more important. Questions? Okay, so now let's see how, since we saw that the instantons are not very useful to determine the dependence of physical quantity on theta, let's see how we can derive in a reliable way how the physical quantities depend on theta, because that will be very useful for later. So without doing a lot of computation, we can already learn how the vacuum energy, some properties of the vacuum energies with vary theta in a non-perturbative way. So we know that a formula for the vacuum energy as a function of theta can be written in terms of the partition function, which is just the Euclidean path integral of QCD, which we can write as the action, Euclidean action of QCD at zero theta plus the term which is proportional to theta. So this is the formula for the vacuum energy as a function of theta, which is just from quantum field theory. This is a positive definite, which means that now this I can also write as the modulus of this. And then I can use Schwarz inequality to say that the modulus of an integral is always less or equal than the integral of the modulus. So this is the integral, the modulus of the integral. So, but this modulus is just e to the minus s at theta equal to zero, because this is just a phase. And now this is equal to e to the minus v of e at zero theta. So from this inequality, we find automatically that the vacuum energy as a function of theta is minimized when theta is equal to zero. So theta equal to zero is a global minimum of the vacuum energy. Moreover, since theta enters just as a phase, we can argue that E must be periodic in theta. And also it's easy to convince yourself that the energy density is even in the exchange of theta. So if you just do a CP, you use CP to redefine the fields, you can map this in minus theta, and then you find that the energy density is invariant, theta in minus theta. So from here, without doing any computation, we already can argue that the expected form of the vacuum energy as a function of theta is periodic periodic of period 2 pi in theta as a global minimum in zero and is even in the exchange of theta minus theta. Okay, but we want more, and we want to actually to reconstruct the functional dependence, exact functional dependence of E as a function of theta, because that we will see that when we will discuss the axiom, this actually reconstruct the axiom potential. So in order to do this, we will use the effective theory of QCD, which is the Carrolls-Lagrangian. So I will not go through all the derivation of the Carrolls-Lagrangian, but I will give you just, for those of you that are not familiar with this, I will just give you an understanding on how to the where they come from. So before doing that, let me do the first step. The first step is to rotate theta completely into the mass matrices. So I remove theta from here, and I'll put direct all the contribution of theta inside the argument of M. So in order to do that, this means that the form of the mass matrix of the quarks is some real contribution. Let me write it in general. I can write it in this way. E to minus I theta over 2 QA, E to minus I theta over 2 QA. So what I've done, I rotated Q left and Q right by a Carroll transformation to rotate theta inside M naught. So you see the global phase is theta if the trace of QA is equal to 1. If I take QA equal to the identity over the number of flavor, I just get the usual formula we wrote before. But now I'm allowing myself to rotate differently all the quarks, and this will be useful for later. So in general, this is the most general thing you can do. You can rotate independently the various quark up, down, and strange in such a way that the trace is equal to 1, and this absorbs the full contribution of theta from the FF tilde term. And M0 is just the real part, M up, M diagonal matrix, M up, M down, M strange, and so on. So if I do this, the full theta dependence is basically inside the quark mass matrix M. And now I'm going to do the low energy limit of QCD. Questions? So the idea is very simple. Can write the generative functional of QCD as a functional of external currents, and that is equal to the functional integral of all the quarks and the gluons and ghosts and so on of the QCD Lagrangian as a function of all the fields and the external source. And then by deriving with respect to the external source, I can derive all the endpoint function of gauge invariant operators. External source are, if you want, what we saw last week are like the spurions that have the couplings, if you want, of the theory, which have non-trivial transformation properties and the global symmetries of the Lagrangian. So for example, the quark masses, the axial and vector current that to which the quarks couple, and so on. Okay, so now these variables here, however, if you see in the functional integral, they are just dummy variables. So I can do a change of variables. I can rewrite this. Can choose the variables that are the leading one at low energy, which are the pions, which are the degrees of freedom that survives at low energy in QCD. And so if I do this transformation, now the functional integral will be a function of pi, the new variables, and j. Now, this transformation in general is not even invertible as problems, but if you go at low energy, then we know that all there is are pions, kaons, the Goldstone bosons. This invertible will be inverted. This transformation will make sense. In particular, S in general will be non-local, in order to reproduce the same dependence on J of the two integrals. But thanks to Wilson, we know that if you do the low energy limit, we can expand the action into local operators, and then only the relevant one at low energy will be important. And this is what we saw also last week. Well, it depends. So we want the endpoint function of J. So if you ask for information of endpoint function of J at low energy, then we know that that can be described in terms of an expansion in local operators, and the expansion in local operators, the irrelevant one are suppressed by the energy. Ah, okay. If you want a J at high energy, of course this doesn't help you. For the question I'm going to ask, I'm going to make sure that the question I ask only involves J at low energy. So for the vacuum energy in particular, is the energy zero. So. I don't know how to work with no local theories, but I know that in the low energy limit, then I can expand the momenta, and then I can write this as a local Lagrangian. Exactly like, for example, imagine you have, like with a weak interaction, you have a W, which is heavy. Imagine you integrate it out. When you integrate it out, you get a local Lagrangian, one over the propagator, one over box. Then you expand in low momenta, and can you write, as long as the expansion makes sense, you are low momenta, the relevant operator are local. Yes. I don't know, but we don't care, because we don't know what S is, but we know how J transforms, how pi transforms, and we're going to write the most general S you can write, which has those symmetries. We expand the momenta, and that's all we need. Very good. So what we need now to characterize the action S is the transformation property under global symmetry of the external currents and the pions. So what are the pions? So the pions are the Goldstone boson of the spontaneously broken chiral symmetry, SUN left cross SUN right, that is broken by the chiral condensate to the diagonal combination, and the broken generator are the associated to the axial generators, which are the pions. So I can characterize this with the matrix U, which is just e to the I pi over f pi. Pi are the pions, which are associated to the broken generator of this symmetry. So m pi is just a matrix, if you want. Pi 0 minus pi 0, root 2 pi plus, root 2 pi minus. And if you go with an f equal to 3, you have also k on say eta here. I'm not going to write everything. And what is important is how U transforms under these symmetries, and U transforms like this by construction. It transforms like SU3 left on one side and SU3 right dagger on the other. For what we need today, we just need how the mass matrix of the quark transforms. Remember, the mass matrix was entering in the operator Q left bar Q right. So by requiring that term is invariant, we know that M mass transforms in the same way. This is NF number of flavors. Sorry for the font. Right, these are these are the chiral transformations. So it's a unitary transformation of the left-handed quarks and right-handed quarks. So if you have n flavor, you can the Lagrangian. Right, L is the generator of this, and R is the generator of that. In on flavor space, yes. Yes. Yeah, because after you do this transformation, basically you don't see gauge quantum numbers. So the only symmetries are the global symmetry, and the only symmetry of QCD, the global symmetry of QCDs are those that are will be relevant to us. Not a low energy. Well, that is the you integrate out. You already integrate out heavy modes, and you are left only with the relevant one at low energy. Okay, very good. So now, knowing this transformation property, we can write what is the general form of S of the Lagrangian for this, which is well. At lowest number of derivatives as this form. So this is the only term you can write that are consistent with the symmetry. So at the two derivative form, without employing M, this is the only invariant term you can write. And then, let me erase this. And then for small quarks, we can expand in M. And the first term in the expansion in M is some other operator. The coefficient is unknown at this level. And it's trace of M dagger U plus M U dagger. And as you see, you can check that those are invariant under this symmetry, and those are the only operator you can write with either two derivative of one insertion of M. Higher terms will involve more derivatives. So here the couplings of so U's, you see, are non-linear representation of the pions. As if you expand in the pions, you have all higher pions interactions. But the number of derivatives fixed is 2. The coupling of these interactions goes like the derivative energy over f pi, which is the scale in the problem there. So if you do loops, for example, using this coupling, loops will be suppressed by this quantity here. So as long as the energy is smaller than this quantity, loops are convergent. The expansion is good, is perturbative. So what is this quantity? F pi is the decay constant of the pions that you can extract from this Lagrangian. You can fit from pion-pion scattering or the decay of the pion. And it's around 100 is point, it's 94 MeV. So you see that the cutoff of this theory is 4 pi f pi, which is order GV, which is where you expect the expansion to break down. Also, at this level on shell, basically p square will be of the same order as the mass, 2b0m. B0 can be fixed by fitting the mass of the pion, for example, the pion mass. If you expand U at the quadratic level, you'll find that this generated a mass for the pion, which is B naught M up plus M down. M here is the mass matrix we wrote before. Without theta, at theta equal to 0, this is just M up and down, if you have two flavors, for example. So from there, you get this formula. Okay, and then knowing the quark masses, you can extract B naught, which is of order a couple of GV. I will discuss this later. I'll discuss this later. From? No. So the chiral Lagrangian doesn't tell you the absolute mass, it only gives you this product or the ratio of masses. So from chiral Lagrangian, you can extract the ratio of masses because you can drop this B naught that you don't know. And from there you can measure the, yes, from there you can say the growth mass, but there is an ambiguity in doing that, which I will discuss later. But okay, I can anticipate that you know this mass is also from the lattice. Okay, higher terms in this Lagrangian will go like higher power of the energy, so higher derivatives or higher insertion of M. And okay, we will be suppressed by this quantity here. Okay, so now that we have all the tools, let's use it to compute first thing, which is the vacuum energy as a function of theta. Well, I will not go through all the computation, but I'll just show you how to do it. So this quantity here, you just to take the scalar potential from here and minimize it. So find the values of the pions that minimize the energy of this. So from there, you find that the energy will be f pi square over 4 to b naught, and then trace of this is 2 the real part of the trace. So what is this? So m dagger we wrote as m up m down, which is what we defined before, m0, and then there is e to the I theta here, taking qa to be diagonal for simplicity. And then u, it's e to the I pi over f pi. If we take only the neutral component, you can show that only the neutral component can get a VeV. This will be pi 0 over f pi minus pi 0 over f pi. Okay, now taking a trace of this is very simple. I will skip some. So you get just cosine and sine of the combination of theta, sorry, theta over 2 here because we have two flavors. So you get a combination of pi 0 plus theta and pi 0 minus theta, cosine and sine of this. And with some algebra and trigonometrics, you can rewrite this as in the following way: minus m pi square f pi square, where m pi square is this combination, root of cosine square theta half plus m down minus m up over m down plus m up square sine square theta half times cosine of pi 0 over f pi minus a phase, and this phase is fixed to be this quantity. Okay, so this is you get cosine and sine here with some combinatorics. You can rewrite it in terms of one cosine and with a phase and a coefficient in front. So this is actually is the energy of theta in pi 0. To find E of theta, you have to minimize this potential. Minimizing this potential, you see, at the minimum, what minimizes this is what maximizes the cosine. So pi 0 will be get a VeV of order phi, well, equal to phi, in such a way that the cosine is 1. So E of theta at the minimum is just this coefficient here. So this is our vacuum energy as a function of theta. So this can be also rewritten as, yes? Yes. Good question. You can show that you are dominated by the light flavors. So we are interested in the vacuum energy, which is the energy at basically at zero, at the lowest configuration. So what we want is to integrate all flavors. So what I did, I already integrated the strange quark, and I can work with the minimum Lagrangian. If I keep the strange quark, I'll get the same, exactly the same result. Of course, this is correct up to correction goes like mmap. Strange quark. Yes, but if you do the computation, it's a good exercise. If you do the computation, you'll see that dependence on MS is suppressed by mmap over MS. And mmap over MS is 1 over 40. So the error you do in considering this only two flavor is 2%. And those corrections are the same order as the higher term that we neglected anyway. Well, when integrated the S quark, the theta will be rotated back to up and down. Because otherwise you cannot see that, for example, when mmap goes to zero, the theta dependence disappears. So this is indeed, and now we're going to show it in the next step. So for example, this you can write it in maybe better way as minus m pi square, f pi square, root of 1 minus 4 m up, m down, over m up plus m down square, sine square theta half. So you see that when any of the quarks goes to zero, the theta dependence completely disappears. And this also, so if you add also the strange quarks, you'll find them up and down, I'm strange, over them up plus and down, with the other combinations. Right, when you, the eta will get a wave of order theta. And that will, go out like a phase now here. So here you see that the pi zero get a wave which is controlled by theta. So if you put also the strange quark and you try to integrate it out, you'll get yes. Right, but then when you integrate, well, that is very simple, right? When you integrate out the top quark from the anomaly, you'll get a theta gg tilde. Right? And then theta gg tilde, I have to rotate it back to this m. If I don't rotate theta gg tilde, so here the first step I did is to rotate the phase from gg tilde to the mass matrices. What if you don't do that? How you see? Theta. So there you see, because from anomaly, the eta prime has a mass term, and that mass term with anomaly, if theta is not rotated to the mass matrix, it show up as a term in the mass matrix, in the mass of the eta prime. Eta prime get a wave. This wave shows as a shift in theta here, and shift in theta here go back to the mass matrix phase here. But it should be invariant. And okay, very good. Now let's see what this implies. So for the first thing is, if theta is zero, of course, from here we reconstruct this is zero, this is zero, this is just one, and expanding pi naught, we reconstruct the pi on mass as usual. Let me erase here. What happens if, for example, mmap is equal to m down, which is not the case. But if mmap is equal to m down, this disappears, and the vacuum energy is the modulus of cos theta over 2. So for mmap equal to m down, the vacuum energy looks like this. and S cusps, because it's the modulus of cos squared theta. It's the modulus of cos theta over 2. However, in the real world, M up is not equal to M down, so you get an extra contribution from here. So if you take the values, M down is twice M up, so this is of order 1/9. So you get a 1/9, a 10% contribution from sine squared theta. So the full potential for M up, a different M up equal to M down over 2, is something that resembles this, but then here it does like this. So it's a very funny potential. It's periodic, it's smooth, and for sure does not resemble the instanton calculation. It's quite non-analytic in the quark masses and in theta. But it's the only approximation I did is to integrate out, the bigger approximation I did is to integrate out MS, and this, as we argued, give a correction of 2-3%. So within 2-3%, this is the we'll say exact form of the vacuum energy as a function of theta in QCD. You can expand in theta here. If you expand in theta, E of theta becomes minus m pi square f pi square for small theta plus m pi square f pi square over 2 m up m down over m up plus m down square theta square. So remember this combination, because this will be the mass of the axion when we introduce the axion. Okay, let's see the effect now of having a finite theta in QCD. So what happens if now I take finite theta and I expand in pi naught, I can find the mass of the pi or the pions at finite theta. And the mass of the pions at finite theta, you see, expanding quadratic this potential in theta naught, is just the mass of the pions at zero theta times this factor here. This factor here. If you take theta to be maximal, pi, this is zero, the sine is one. So the pion mass is the whole pion mass times this factor here, which is md minus m up times md plus m up. So the pion mass at theta equal to pi is the pion mass at zero theta times the factor m down minus m up over m down plus m up, which is for m up equal to 1/2 m down, it's 1/3. So you see the correction is, the effect is not small. If we were to live on the same world, but with maximal theta, the pion would be a factor of root 3 lighter. Even more is the effect, for example, on the neutron-proton splitting. The neutron-proton splitting is the difference between m down minus m up. Now you see that going to maximal pi corresponds basically to take all the formula and exchange m up with minus m up. So theta equal to pi is equivalent to consider all the formula as before with the new m0, which is minus m up, m down. So this explains easily what we find here. But for the proton-neutron splitting, this means that instead of being the difference with the m down minus m up, becomes the sum. So it becomes a factor of 3 larger. Actually, it becomes even more the factor of 3 because there are also QED effects that cancel a little bit the 3-level result. So I think it becomes like a factor of 6 larger. But the neutron lifetime goes like the difference to the fifth power because it's volume, phase volume suppressed. So it means that the lifetime of the neutron will increase by a factor of phi to the fifth or so. So instead of decaying in 14 minutes, it will decay in a fraction of a second. So here we see that going to maximal theta has a profound implication for nuclear physics. Also, the pions will acquire a CP violating coupling to the nucleons, which is the pion-nucleon coupling will become a scalar, not pseudo-scalar, because you break CP. So the pion will become lighter and mediate long-range forces and will completely change all nuclear binding energies. Okay. So probably we cannot live on a world with the maximal pi, but there is probably no problem. The moment theta becomes small enough, over the 10%, 1%, that will probably be enough not to change any nuclear physics we know of. Questions about this part? Yes, the splitting increases. But maybe nuclei will become unstable. Some. Sorry, say it again. If the mass of the up zero, yes. Yes, here, if take M up equal to zero, then the theta dependence completely disappear, and you get... well, everything, all the E of theta, the dependence on theta disappears completely, both in the pion mass, in the vacuum energy, in everything. Actually, this is a very generic result, because when the M up equal to zero, now the argument of the determinant is zero, and the theta becomes non-physical because you can redefine it away with a Fourier definition. Well, okay. So now let me just sketch the last quantity I wanted to show how it depends on theta, which is the one that where you get the bound. On the stronger experimental bound on theta, which is the neutron EDM. Okay, to compute, okay, the neutron EDM, it's basically the effect induced by a dimension 5 operator of this kind. So you have a neutron, and you have an electric EDM, where now f mu nu is the photon. And this operator breaks CP, and the coefficient dn has been experimentally has been bounded from experiments, and the bound on this coefficient here is pretty strong. This coefficient here must be smaller than 3 × 10⁻²⁶ centimeter times E. I don't know why people still use this units, but okay, this is the one usually used. So how is this important for the theta term? So the theta term breaks CP, so at a certain level will induce this kind of operator. So how to estimate how much theta induces this kind of operator and what this bound means in terms of theta. So in order to do this, well, here the things become a little bit less under control, because now we need nucleons, and for nucleons, Carrel-Lagrangian it's a little bit borderline, because nucleons per se have a mass of order GeV, so you will say they are not within the approximation of small energies. In principle, you could do, what you really need is this changed energy small compared to the cutoff of your theory. In that limit, you can treat the neutrons, the nucleons, as external sources. And as long as the energy exchanged is small, you can have a good energy expansion. Unfortunately, the energy exchange is of order the pions, and the pions is the pion mass is of order the splitting between the nucleons and the next resonances, so the expansion is not very well under control. But in any case, we can use it just to have an order of magnitude idea of what the effect of theta on this. And this is what basically was done in the seminal paper by Kreuter, De Vecchia, Veneziano, and Witten. So the idea is very simple. Let's write analogous theory for the chiral expansion with the nucleons. So you will write a Lagrangian of this form. So n here is a doublet with include the proton and the neutron. If you only consider two flavors, you have a kinetic term, a mass term, and then an interaction with external currents. In particular, we will need the axial current. So you can write this operator here. And then correction proportional to the mass, the quark masses. And you can write two terms, the trace of chi times n bar n. I'm going to tell you what all these symbols are in a minute. Okay, so A mu is the axial current and is made out of pions. And the form is I over 2 xi d mu xi dagger minus xi dagger d mu xi. Xi is basically the pion, is the square root of u, so it's basically e to the I pi over 2, f pi. So this is the axial current made of pions, which transform correctly to write this under the flavor group to write that term. Chi is the combination that we saw before, but now written in terms of xi, is xi dagger m xi dagger plus emission conjugate. So that is the analogous of mu dagger plus u dagger m that we wrote before. Maybe there is a 1/2 here. Okay, so this is the lowest order Lagrangian, and this is all we need. Okay, and then you want to, theta appears inside M as before. And now we want this contribution from theta will break CP, and we want to see how this will go into this kind of operator. So this kind of operator, this is the effective operator that generate this, the coupling between a photon and a neutron. And in terms of this Lagrangian, you see the neutron is neutral, so it doesn't couple minimally with the photon. So this contribution will be generated at one loop from this Lagrangian. And the relevant loop is of this form. So here you have a neutron, then you have a coupling with the pions, proton and pi minus. The pi minus now is charged, can couple to the photon, and then they recombine to the neutron. This coupling here, you can extract it from here. You see A mu is the derivative of the pions, so here you have n bar d mu pions n, which is a coupling between the pions and the neutrons, so will be of order a derivative, which is a momentum, over f pi, which is the relevant coupling here, and ga, which can be extracted from the neutron decays is over coupling order one. Then here you have a coupling to the photon from pions, which is E times the momentum, because it's the minimal coupling of a scalar to a photon. And then from here, we need a certain point, we need to break CP. So we can do it here. This is a coupling between the pions and the nucleons, which breaks CP. So we can pick it from here. If we take the component chi1, chi2 here, and we know that theta break CP here. If you expand this in pi on theta, you'll find the first contribution to be from here. You can get the contribution, which is proton bar neutron pi times theta, expanding in theta and pions, times m up, m down over m up plus m down. And maybe there is an f pi. This is what you get by expanding this term in terms of pions and theta. This B here is fixed, is a coupling of order one, and is fixed by fitting the splitting of proton and neutron masses. So this is a mass term for the neutrons, which is proportional to the quark, and is different for the proton and the neutron. Okay, but up to coefficient of order one, this is what we need. So at the end, this integral will be of order what? Well, we get a 1 over 4 pi square from the loop, 2 f pi in the denominator from the two couplings, coupling of order 1, thetas, and combination of m up, m down over m up plus m down. And the loop is log divergent, so you get a log here. Now, the scale dependence of mu will be erased once you introduce higher dimensional operators in the Carrier-Lagrangian. So since we get the first contribution at the loop level, the first contribution is loop suppressed, so it will be, means that it will be of the same order as higher dimensional operators. The anomalous dimension of this higher dimensional operator will depend on mu and will cancel the mu dependence. However, this will leave you an uncertainty by the fact that you don't know what are the coefficients of these higher dimensional operators, which is basically the fact that you don't know how to fix mu at this level. Because of this, I've been quite cavalier with the coefficients, because at the end, all you can say is just the order of magnitude of this contribution, because we don't know all the couplings that enter in the Carrier-Lagrangian. So, okay, let's do a very crude estimate. From here, this will go like 4 pi f pi square, it's 1 GeV. So this will be over, induce EDM of order, M quark over 1 GeV square times theta, and there was a E from here, times some log, and this is order 1 over 100 GeV, basically, from the fact that small, yes, times some factor of order 1. Now, if you convert GeV in centimeters, you'll find that this is of order 10 to the minus 16 centimeters times he. Well, it's not, we could have guessed this from the beginning, right? We expect the dipole moment to be of order one of the mass of the particle, which is at the GeV scale. And then there is an extra contribution that is a suppression proportional to the quark masses, because we know that when the quark mass goes to zero, all the dependence on theta mass disappear. This is 10 to the minus 6 centimeter. The bounds is 10 to the minus 26. Roughly, we'll say that theta must be smaller than 10 to the minus 10. The actual coefficient is unknown. there are estimates based on very different models from chiral quark models, large NC, chiral Lagrangian various form, and they disagree, I mean, they agree within a factor of 10. So all we can say at the moment is that this is the order of magnitude of the bound, and we probably have to wait for maybe lattice QCD to say something reliable, although at the moment it's still unable to do this type of computation. Okay, from this bound, we see that we really need a high accuracy cancellation between theta naught and the argument of determinant of M if they are order one to achieve this small number. Okay, any questions? I hope so. They try every now and then, but at the moment it's still, it's very hard because these are neutrons and the operators that are involved are very noisy from the point of view of calculation because it has to do with the topological charge. So I don't know what would be the timeline expectation for that. The splitting comes from this term here. So you see this proportional to the quark masses. And you see M, so put the pion to zero. This is just chi becomes M. M, we said it's M up, M down. So the difference between proton and neutron mass is the difference between the first and the second component. So it's proportional to M up minus M down. The exact prefactor of this difference is this. So this you have to fit with experiments and or lattice. But it tells you that it goes as you would expect with the difference of M up over M down, minus M down, which is the order parameter of the breaking of the isospin symmetry. Sorry, this is was SU2. For the previous one, yeah, you can do it also for with the three flavors, for example, and then you find that the formula will be the same as the one we wrote up to terms that goes like the smallest mass quark, which is M up, over the quark mass that you neglected, which is M strange and charm and so on. So yes, converge very fast. Thank you. Oh, sorry. Ah. Okay, very good. So we found the problem. So let's see possible solutions. So since the lectures are on axions, there are two types of solutions. I will start with the one that are not axions first. And there are two families, as long as I know, all the axions, the solution to the theta problem can be gathered in two families. One family uses CP invariants in the UV, in the fundamental theory, and the other uses instead a so-called Peche-Quinn symmetry that we are going to see in a moment. So they both use symmetries, but in a different way, and there are different symmetries. So the first I'm going to discuss is the first family is the one based on CP. So the idea is very simple. You'll say, okay, if we require CP to be a fundamental symmetry of our fundamental Lagrangian, then both the contribution on GG tilde on the gluon part and the argument of the determinant of the mass will be zero, so we don't have any theta problem. At that point, we have to break CP because we know that CP is broken in nature. So the whole point is to find mechanisms that when they break CP, they produce CKM angle and maybe extra CP for baryogenesis and so on, without reintroducing a contribution to the physical theta. So this class of model try to achieve this. There are various implementations of this idea. I'm not going to review all of them. I'm going only to discuss one or maybe two, which is, one is so-called an Elson-Barr model, and the other is Hiller-Schmalz, which is based on supersymmetry. Maybe the second, I don't have time to do it. Okay, so what is the first? So this is based on a model proposed by Nelson sometimes ago, and then generalized into a theorem by Barr. And okay, I'm going to tell you what is the theorem, so which allows you to write to construct a whole family of models that satisfy the requirement you want to have a small theta. So what you want is that your first of all, you have to assume that your fundamental theory is CP invariant. Is CP is an exact symmetry in the UV. Then you need CP to be broken spontaneously. And it's broken spontaneously by some wave of a field. Let's call it VCP broken, some scale V. Then let's call F fermions with the same quantum numbers as the fermions of the standard model. So F, if you can imagine to be a good, under a good approximation, the fermion of the standard model. So the theory says the fermions F with the quantum number of the standard model, and then extra fermions R. These fermions comes into with the real representation of the standard model gauge group, which means that they have can be complex, but you need the same number, for example, fundamental and anti-fundamental. Okay, so if your theory has this matter content and this pattern of breaking of CP, spontaneous, then the theorem says that you have zero theta at three level if the following conditions are satisfied. So the conditions are two. You just need that the wave that breaks electroweak symmetry, the Higgs wave, only enters in F inside only appears through UCAVAs of FF terms. So only UCAVAs that involve fermions F. So you don't have UCAVA that involves this vacuum breaking term, electroweak vacuum breaking term, with FR or RR terms. Second hypothesis is that instead, the CP breaking web only appears in UCAVA involving mixed FR terms. So if these conditions are satisfied, then you can prove that theta remains zero at three level. Okay, this is, I'll show you a sketch of this. So this pattern means the following, that if you try to write, for example, the mass matrix, of the fermions coming from this, the structure of this mass matrix is of this form. Here taking generically two types of R fields. So V electroweak can only appear here. it will appear with some Yukawa. And instead, the VCP breaking, in this case, can only appear either here with some Yukawa or here with some other Yukawa. And then you can have mass terms for R1, R2, because a real representation can have mass terms. So this is the most general structure you can have. You can have VLA through weak must only enter inside F, and CP breaking can only enter into cross term of R1 and FR2. You cannot write CP breaking on these terms here, although they involve F times R, because of quantum numbers. If you switch on this, then this must be zero, because if you switch on this, it means that, for example, R1 has the same quantum numbers as F bar. And then you cannot write this term without breaking it through weak, which was the assumption here. So you can convince yourself that this is the most general structure you can write with this assumption. Very good. And now you can convince yourself, indeed, that if you compute the argument of the determinant of M, this is the argument of the determinant of just the diagonal terms, because this one cannot contribute to the determinant, because they're always, when you try to compute the determinant, they're always multiplied by zeros. So this is trivially true if you have only one fermion of each kind. If you have three generations, this will be matrices. But if you think a little bit, you'll find that this is, remains true also in that case. OK, so this is basically is the proof of the theorem. OK, now we can ask what guarantees that these assumptions are implemented. In principle, in effective field theory, you should write all the terms that are allowed by the selection rules of your theory. Well, this is a model-dependent question. There are models where these are zero because of gauge interaction forbids you to write those terms. So there are selection rules that forbids to write terms in these blocks here. Exactly like you cannot write a baryon number breaking operator in the standard model at the renormalizable level. But this is a model-dependent, of course, property. So there's another thing to notice is that although the argument of determinant of M is zero, and of course theta naught is zero because we require CP to be exact in the UV, you can still produce CKM breaking, non-zero CKM phases. So here the Yukawa of the standard model have this contribution, why not? But the true fermions of the standard model, low energy, are an admixture of F and R, because you have to diagonalize this matrix. The mixing is proportional to the ratio of this, the diagonal part and the off-diagonal part. So if the mixing is of order 1, which means that M1 is of the same order as these terms, or these terms, so the same order M2, then the mixing will be of order 1, and you can transmit CP breaking from off-diagonal to basically the fermion of the standard model. You can create order 1 phases for the Yukawa at low energy. This is because you can have the standard model fermions at low energy can be order 1 admixture of F and R, if this ratio is order 1. This without inducing any arg that m different from 0. Of course, at this moment, you should worry about what about, this is true at tree level, what about loops? Not going to go through all the loops, but the result is that as long as this UCAV are small, you know, inside the loops, in order to get CP breaking, you have to put insertion of a VCP breaking. And this insertion are weighted with the UCAV, lambda 1 and lambda 2. As long as these couplings here are small, you can show that all the thresholds that you get at one loop are suppressed by lambda square and a loop factor. So for example, you should worry, for example, one loop of contribution to this matrix element that breaks CP. So I just draw a loop. So you can worry, for example, of this contribution. So this is the Higgs, this is the fermions F. So this operator renormalizes this term here, which is Higgs FF. In order to break CP, you have to put two insertions. So imagine these lines here is heavy radial mode of CP breaking, for example, BEV. So this will be R, this will be R, but the Higgs couple only to F. So you have to put two insertions of F here. And these are lambda VCP. Lambda VCP. And if you estimate this loop is finite, it's just a threshold correction from the heavy mode. When you integrate out this, you'll get contribution, which is a loop factor suppressed, and then lambda square suppressed. So as long as lambda is smaller than 10 to the minus, say, 4, 3 or 4, then the induced loop corrections to the theta term will be below 10 to the minus 10. So all you have to do is to assume that now lambdas are suppressed by 10 to the minus 3 or 4. Of course, at this moment, it becomes a little bit more fortuitous the fact that the CKM phase is of order 1. Because in order to have a CKM phase of order 1, you need this to be of the same order as this. But these are independent parameters. On top of that, lambda is also suppressed by 10 to the minus 4, so it seems it may seem like an accident, the fact that at the end of the day you can you get a phase of CKM or the one. Okay, this is just a matter of taste, I guess. But this is basically. So, and the people also checked that also at two loop level, the same assumption guarantees that, of course, theta is 10 to the minus 10, so one loop is usually not enough. You have to go also two loop to be sure that it don't generate any phase, diagonal phase to the argument. But apparently, this is all you need for the model to work. So one drawback of this model is indeed that this, of course, you have to make several assumptions, in particular that, so these are, may seem a little bit fortuitous. And of course, you also need to reproduce CKM of order one. And on top of that, this model, you may think, is maybe fragile under extra correction. Every time you add extra new layers of physics, you need to be sure that they don't spoil all these assumptions and they don't reintroduce CP breaking in the theta term. I don't know. Yes. You mean this? Right? Well, you can plus one, maybe you can write plus one. But, the simplest example of potential? Uh, simplest. No. Yeah, I want to scale a scalar couple to fermion, and then guess if you write a scalar couple to pseudo scalar fermionic bilinear, and then you give a wave to the fermion, to the scalar, you may break CP, or just with scalars maybe. I don't know what's the simplest. I haven't thought about it. Of this kind? Well, define simple. Well, Nelson and Barr wrote models, grand unified model with some flavor symmetry, and giving quantum numbers to this, so basically adding extra fermions in the complete SUFI representation with some flavor group. I think they just needed a couple of fields and some flavor symmetry to forbids also the off-diagonal terms, SO3. I think also with Michele we probably have a model. Now, we wrote a model of gauging flavor in the standard model. And after you gauge flavor, you can ask what. Gauging flavor means gauging the full SU3 to the fifth flavor, see, and then make it spontaneously break. Then you can ask what is the. That gauge. After you gauge it, the tree is anomalous. You have gauge anomalies. So you have to cancel them. You have to put extra fermions. And apparently, the minimum. Set of fermions you have to put to cancel all anomalies satisfy automatically this requirements and have all the zeros you have just by gauging variance. So that will automatically be a good Nelson-Barr model. So just gauging the flavor of the standard model group and require anomaly cancellation. So the extra fermions. Because in order to you cover generated by wave expectation value of scalar fields, and those expectation values, in order to reproduce also the CKM phase, has to break CP. We don't remember if we have an explicit potential that actually, after minimization, explain all, but. Actually, I'm not even sure that, okay, maybe not even the Nelson-Barr initial model. I think they worry about the set of the break CP. I think they just assume that there is some mechanism that give a CP breaking bab to some scalar field. That I'm not sure. So I don't know how complicated the model becomes after you implement also that sector. Oh, you mean the theta term? Right, we already discussed this last week. So, yes, there is, well, for SU2, there is an analogous term that you can write. In that case, however, I was going to discuss it probably tomorrow, but. Okay. Good. Yeah, now, yes.
So regarding the loops and sticking to QCD or even Purium mills, how much is it known about the dependence of a theta angle on energy scale?
Oh, you mean the running of theta?
Yeah. Is it exactly marginal, irrelevant?
Well, he is an expert. well, the running, there is a contribution from CKM, CP breaking to theta, and there is an estimate that at 7 loops, theta gets a log divergent contribution. And 7 loops come just from the fact that you have to put the main insertion of the UCAVAS to reconcile the Jarskog invariant and break CP with that. And plus extra. But I'm not an expert of that, so I don't know.
But somehow simpler. Can you just address this question as it was saying in lattice QCD?
Question was for pure QCD.
Ah, for pure QCD? Well, I think in that case, theta doesn't run, no?
I think for this discussion, theta does not run. If you think of FF2 as a local operator that you can insert with some non-zero momentum, then there is a run which has been computed, in fact. It comes at two loops, four two loops at a run.
So that is defined with a factor of just running from. You just do some doubt to the run.
Yes, yes. Without that, yeah.
Well, maybe I'm not good in pointing out my question, but I can imagine that in pure QCD, in perturbation theory, theta doesn't run. But outside perturbation theory, what is it known?
Ask a different question of, if you take the operator FF tilde with some non-zero momentum, what is its anomalous dimension? That's computed and is non-zero. I can give you a reference. It's a very technical question.
More questions?
Out of curiosity, is there a good archive reference or something to this if like we want to read about like something we're talking about here?
Everything or something particular?
Well, I don't know. Like some of the lectures have listed some references to look at. I don't know if they're... Yeah, either one, I guess.
well, there are reviews on axions. On this part, not sure there is a review that encodes everything, but... if you want, at the end, I can produce some reference list for what I used in the course, and then.
More questions? Okay, if not, we can go for lunch.